Hello. There we go. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the only sovereign who dwells in light, Jesus Christ, who came to save sinners, the Holy Spirit who lives within us. Amen. Come, let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. God of overflowing grace, we come to you with repentant hearts. Forgive us for shallow thankfulness. Forgive us for passing by the ones in need. Forgive us for setting our hopes on fleeting treasures. Forgive us our neglect and thoughtlessness. Bring us home from the wilderness of sin and strengthen us to serve you in all that we do and say. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. There is joy in heaven over every sinner who repents. By the grace of God in Christ Jesus, who gave himself up for us all, your sins are forgiven you. You are made free. Rejoice with the angels and with one another. We are home in God's mercy, now and forever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Share God's peace by greeting those around you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Worthy is Christ, the Lamb who was slain, whose blood set us free to be people of God. Power, riches, wisdom, and strength, and
the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Direct us, O Lord God, in all our doings with your continual help, that in all our works, begun, continued, and ended in you, we may glorify your holy name, and finally, by your mercy, bring us to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well. my soul. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought, my sin, not in part, but the bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul, my soul.
A reading from Deuteronomy. See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity, if you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I am commanding you, observing his commandments, decrees, and ordinances, then you shall live and become numerous, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you do not hear, but are led astray to bow down to other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall perish. You shall not live in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying him, and holding fast to him. For that means life to you and length of days, so that you may live in the land that the Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. The word of the Lord.
Happy are they who have not walked in the counsel of the wicked, nor lingered in the ways of sinners, nor sat in the seats of the scornful. Their delight is in the law of the Lord, and they meditate on God's teaching day and night. They are like trees planted by streams of water, bearing fruit in due season, with leaves that do not wither. Everything they do shall prosper. It is not so with the wicked. They are like chaff which the wind blows away. Therefore the wicked shall not stand upright when judgment comes, nor the sinner in the counsel of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of
our dear friend and co-worker, to APR, our sister, to Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church in your house. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. When I remember you in my prayers, I always thank my God because I hear of your love for all the saints and your faith toward the Lord Jesus. I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective when you perceive all the good that we may do for Christ. I have indeed received much joy and encouragement from your love, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, my brother. For this reason, though, I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do your duty. Yet I would rather appeal to you on the basis of love. And I, Paul, do this as an old man, and now also as a prisoner of Christ Jesus. I am appealing to you for my child Onesimus, whose father I have become during my imprisonment. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful both to you and me. I am sending him, that is, my own heart, back to you. I wanted to keep him with me so that he might be of service to me in your place during my imprisonment for the gospel. But I prefer to do nothing without your consent, in order that your good deed might be voluntary and not something forced. Perhaps this is the reason he was separated from you for a while, so that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has wronged you in any way or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will repay it. I say nothing about you. You're owing me even your own self. Yes, brother, let me have this benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I am writing to you, knowing that you will do even more than I say. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel. Now large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and he turned and said to them, "Whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not first sit down and estimate the cost, to see whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it will begin to ridicule him, saying, 'This fellow began to build and was not able to finish.' Or what king, going out to wage war against another king, will not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to oppose the one who comes against him with 20,000? If he cannot, then while the other is still far away, he sends a delegation and asks for the terms of peace. So therefore, none of you can become my disciple if you do not give up all your possessions." The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. I would like to invite the children to come forward. Morning, Zach. Morning, Casper. I'm going to show you three things, all carvings. This is carved out of a chunk of wood, and it's so heavy, I think maybe it's wood from the rubber tree. And do you know what I like about this? Doesn't it look like that man is in terrible distress? Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Oh, I couldn't think of a sermon title. I had, on this I have, Hate Your Family. And it just didn't seem to be right. Hate Your Family. So, but we'll find out. And it's based on the thought, what Jesus says. Whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. And then, whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Harsh words, aren't they? Let's begin with talking about Terry Hoepner, coach for the Indiana Hoosiers, their football team. Terry Hoepner, the reason this particular story struck me was that in the past month, we've had two members undergo brain surgery. Kathy Zinter had brain surgery about 4 weeks ago and is doing very well. And, of course, this week, Lucy Stillwell. Well, Terry Hoepner had brain surgery and then went back to coaching for 18 months, And the tumor came back and had brain surgery again. And so he was interviewed by a reporter, and the reporter asked him, what was the experience like having brain surgery? And his response was, it was the best thing that ever happened to me. Doesn't that sound like coach talk? This is the best thing that ever happened to me. And he was pressed a little bit further. You don't mean that, do you? He says, no, yes, I really mean it. It's the best thing that ever happened to me because it changed my priorities in life. I realized I was living my life all wrong. I was living my life contrary to the way it should be lived. And he said, this is how I live now. Faith is first. Family is second. The Hoosiers are third. Or we could say work is third. Brain surgery, the best thing that ever happened to me. It's a little like Gale Sayers, who, if you remember, Gale Sayers played his career for the Chicago Bears football team. He wore a chain around his neck, and on it was a big medallion. And the medallion read, I am third. I am third. Great discussion starter. And his answer, when anybody asked him, what does it mean that you are third? He said, God is first, family is second, me, Gale Sayers, is third. Well, when Jesus tells us to hate our families, he's trying to help us set priorities. We'll talk about what that means, but it's hyperbole. It's called hyperbole, where Jesus uses shocking language, but it's also a Semiticism, which I guess is part of the hyperbole. Fred Craddock says the word for hate is a Semitic expression meaning to turn away from, to detach oneself from. It is not the same as our expression, I hate you. To turn away from. Father and mother, well, they're great. But there comes a point, we always hope, where you go, Mom and Dad, I love you, but I'm not living here anymore, right? To turn away from, to detach oneself from. Craddock, he suggests it's action, not emotion. It's not an emotion-filled word like our word hate is. It's an action word, turn from. What is demanded of disciples is that in the network of many loyalties in which all of us live, the claim of Christ and the gospel not only takes precedence, but, in fact, redefines the others. This can and will necessarily involve some detaching, some turning away. So, Terry Hoepner redefined his loyalties. Gale Sayers redefined his loyalties. Based on that statement that Jesus makes, whoever comes to me and does not hate, does not detach oneself from, begin to turn away, realize their priority. And their priority is not the greatest priority. Father, mother, wife, and children, brothers and sisters. Frederick Buechner gives an example of this. Frederick Buechner is an author, a pastor. He's written probably 20 books. And he tells of his wife's great-grandfather, who was also a pastor. And his wife's great-grandfather was George Shinn. And he was a pastor in the 1880s. And Pastor Shinn went to an elderly woman's house with her doctor. And when the doctor got there, the doctor said, told the woman the grim news that she was dying, she was near death, there was nothing he could do. And this was a woman who was didn't have a lot of money and lived by herself, didn't have many friends. And she turned to Pastor Shinn and said, "Can you find a woman who will just spend these last few hours with me while I die?" Pastor Shinn thought this shouldn't be too hard. So he and the doctor started going, it was middle of the night, going house to house, knocking on doors and sometimes throwing pebbles at windows. And every woman they encountered said, "Oh, I've got children, I can't go." Or, "Oh, no, 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 I just wouldn't know what to do in a situation like that." Everyone had an excuse. And then Pastor Shinn said, and Buechner says the story sounded as if it was told like a biblical parable. They rapped at the humble door of an Irish woman, the mother of a brood of children. She put her head out of the window. "Who's there? And what can you want at this time of night?" They tell her the situation. He says, her warm Irish heart could not resist. "Will you come?" they ask. "Sure, I'll come, and I'll do the best I can." The account in the book ended with, "And she did come, and she did the best she could." What is Jesus calling us to do? Detach ourselves. Come. Take up his cross. Follow. Do. Sometimes very, very simple. Instead, we get so involved with so many different loyalties tugging us in life. And often it's not because we're terrible people or mean people. Life is not easy. Have you noticed that? Life is not easy. I contracted the flu this week that was going through the child care center. And let me tell you, life is not easy. So Martin Luther says, from that, sort of our survival instinct, he says, and it is the definition of sin. We tend to curve in upon ourselves. The self curved in upon ourselves. We want to serve me because I think serving me is going to help me survive and help me live. Let me give you an example of it. I was going to the hospital this week, make calls, and there was a man with a t-shirt with, in big letters, these three statements. Talk about his priorities in life. Whiskey. Women. White tail. I'm sure that meant hunting. Deer, right? And I go, if that man really believes that, really follows that, he is really curved in on himself, is he not? But we all have those things that cause us to curve in on ourselves and, oh, how am I going to survive? How will I best survive? I mean, it could be winning, work, wealth, good things. We get so curved in. And Jesus comes, and he's trying to pull that self out of itself. Come, give up your life itself. Take up the cross and follow me. And in so doing, we find life. We find God's life. Jesus needs to use that harsh, we see as harsh language. Detach yourself from father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, and even life itself. So, with all those voices, how does God get through to us? He just keeps challenging us, and he keeps calling us through the cross, through the very love of God and the forgiveness of God in Christ. Isn't that ultimately what the cross means to us? He calls us through the cross. Come, follow, trust me, find life in me. Whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. It's a story of how hard this is. Told by a missionary. This missionary's name is Milton Cunningham. Pastor Cunningham was on a plane, airplane, and when he got on the plane, three seats, sitting next to the window, was a young girl. She was Down syndrome, had Down syndrome. And he sat down next to her and said, hi. And she said, hi, mister. And then after a few moments of silence, she said, say, mister, did you brush your teeth today? He was rather taken aback by that question, thought maybe he's got a problem. And he said, seeing that it's a little Down syndrome's girl, he said, well, yes, I brushed my teeth today. And she said, well, good, I did too. That is what you're supposed to do. And then he looked at her. She looked at him and said, hey, mister. And he said, yes. Do you smoke? And that was easy for him to answer. No, I do not smoke. And her response was, well, that's good, because smoking will kill you. And then after a bit, she says, hey, mister. And he goes, yes. Do you love Jesus? Well, he's a missionary. He felt safe in answering that question. He said, yes, I love Jesus. And her response says, good. Everybody should love Jesus. And about then, a man came and sat on the aisle seat. So the little girl nudges Milton Cunningham and says, ask him. And he goes, no, no, I can't ask him. And she goes, ask him. And she was very insistent, so he says, excuse me, sir. I have a friend here who wants to know, did you brush your teeth this morning? And he goes, he looks and sees the little girl and realizes it's an innocent question and says, yes, I brushed my teeth. And then, of course, she nudges him again, mister, ask him. So he goes, excuse me, my little friend has another question. Do you smoke? Got that answered. And then after a longer pause, she nudges him again. Mister, ask him. And he goes, no, I can't ask him that question. That's too personal. This is a missionary. And you can just feel God tugging him to get him to come out of himself and share the good news. Mister, ask him. And she was so insistent that he turns and says, sir, this is a rather personal question, but my friend wants me to ask you, do you love Jesus? And he said there was a long pause. And the man said, you know, that's a good question. Because I had no time, it seems, for my spiritual life. And then Milton Cunningham and he had a long conversation about the gospel and about the love of God in Christ. Well, people, today, Jesus is tugging to pull us out of ourselves, give us love, grace, forgiveness. Come, find your life in me and share that life. Take up your cross and follow. Amen.
Living together in trust. Let us.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." You may be seated.
Thank you.
body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen and keep you in his grace. Amen.
We come again to you, O God, giving you thanks that in this feast of mercy, you have embraced us and healed us, making us one in the body of Christ. Go with us on our way, equip us for every good work, that we may continue to give you thanks by embracing others with mercy and healing. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen.
Lisa, you first. I think everyone, if you just come nice and close, we don't have to wait for you to walk here.
Don't be afraid.
There you go.
Good morning, everybody. On behalf of the Parish Life Committee, I'm here to remind you and to invite you to come to the potluck next Sunday. It will be at 12:15 in the Fellowship Hall. Of course, we want all of you to come and enjoy the fellowship.
books, but $5 to ship.
We actually ordered, I don't know if you ordered five, I ordered 10. So we have some extra books.
Okay, all right. My confirmation class, the ninth graders, meet this week, Wednesday. And I will contact everybody. Receive this benediction. By the way, if you're visiting, we never have announcements this long. Receive this benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Guided by the gospel,